written communication in management. So hopefully you will learn a lot regarding the communication skill, and I would request Miss Ananya, Miss Prasansha ma'am, to kindly start the session as per her convenience. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Hiba ma'am. Good afternoon, one and all. So today we shall learn about written communication. I have shared my presentation with all of you. I guess all of you could see it. If anyone has any problem in seeing the presentation, please let me know. I would like to request our technical person, Mr. Nishant, my voice is audible or not, that also please let me know whether my voice is properly audible or not. And the second thing is that whether my presentation is properly visible or not, please let me know about this.
Yeah, it's visible only. Your voice is also audible.
Okay, so I'll start. So friends, today we shall learn about written communication for management. Written communication is something that is very important in our life. The written communication is a thing that is documented. If you are working in an office or you are in a business, writing something in a paper and pen, using a paper and pen, is a authentic information that can be kept as a proof, as a record throughout the lifetime. So you have to be very particular and very specific and very much careful whenever you are doing a written communication. Now let's learn about in detail about the written communication in management. Now, written, we are very much aware about the communication process. Now, what do we mean by communication process? In the communication process, we have four things. One is the sender, one is the receiver, and then between is the channel, and second is the medium, and the last thing is the feedback. So we have four things. First is sender, receiver, feedback, and in between two things operate, that is channel, and the second is medium. So sender, again, here the channel is writing. Writing may be in the form of a mail, in the form of a letter, in the form of a memo, it can be anything. So here the channel is writing. So the sender is sending the information in the form of writing to the receiver. Now let's know what is writing. Writing is one of the best methods to communicate. Writing is one of the oldest non-forms of communication. We know right from the 20th century, when our kings used to rule, that time also they used to write letters. They used to write farman jari karte the ki farman jari ho tula se time re. So that is, what is that? That is, writing is the oldest forms of communication, and that is something authentic. Until and unless something is written, no one is going to believe that. In today's age of information and technology, no one is writing, but we are more digitalized. We are writing in the form of email, in the form of WhatsApp, Facebook chat, hike, everything. Now, what are the goals and objectives of written communication? Now, whenever you are writing something in examination, someone will ask why written communication is important. It is important for future reference. It is important for keeping it as a record of evidence. It is very important to measure someone's progress. It is important for keeping the precedents as a proof that whatever has happened in the history, we know through written communication. Avoiding mistakes, if we have something in writing, verbal thing, once it comes out of the mouth, then it goes into air. We cannot keep the record until and unless it is recorded. The verbal messages are recorded, but the written mistakes, we can learn from the things that we have jotted down or noted down. Then we can learn and we can avoid mistakes. It helps in effective decision making. We can refer to the history while making our decisions if anything is kept written. It increases the organizational efficiency, because if the written communication is a more formal method of communication, therefore it increases the organizational efficiency, and it has legal requirements. Of course, it has legal requirements. We know very well in law, in advocate, in court, everything, it has to be written. Written proof is required. So it has legal implications as well. Now, why written communication? why we have to go for a written communication. As we have already learned that it creates a permanent record for future reference and it is easily distributed. You can pass on to your message to as many as people as, because sometimes people don't have time to talk with you. They cannot converse with you all the time. Sometimes you cannot, you don't, but your messages, if it is in writing, you can send it to n number of people without their permission. If you have their mail ID or their phone number, even if that person have no time to talk with you or have don't want to talk with you, but you have to communicate with that person, then you can send it through written communication. All recipients receive the same information. Yeah, at a time, like when we, if we are addressing a gathering, then publicly we can transmit information together. When we are addressing a lot of people like our politicians do, there are huge gathering. But it's not possible for us to have a huge gathering all the time. And if you want to disseminate some information that we feel like for example, recently Sushant Singh has committed suicide. Everyone has their own understanding about it. So we want to message something to the public that no, societal tendency is not good or he is a good person. We want that this should be in public. So we can post a message in writing in the Facebook. So we can, all the recipients over the Facebook can receive the same information if it's a written communication. Necessary for legal and binding documentation. Now, what does a question a writer ask? Whenever you start writing, what is the questions arise in your mind? How do I begin? What should be my first sentence? What is my purpose? How do I make my point clear? How do I create a logical flow? How do I say what I mean? How do I avoid grammatical errors? How can I make my message brief? How can I create a visual effect? You know, first of all, first impression is the last impression. So your first line should be so powerful that it should attract the readers who are reading your message. Your purpose should be very clear. You should not write vague things in your written message. Now you have to make your point clear. What do you want to convey the message? Logical flow. If you are writing 2-3 paragraphs together, your first paragraph should be connected to second, second should be connected to third, and third to be fourth. And how do I say what I mean? Like, what should be my language? Whether it should be formal or it should be informal. And of course, whether it's Hindi, Odia, English, Telugu, whatever medium you are writing, your written communication, it should be free from grammatical errors. And your message should be brief, because these days people are very busy. They don't have time to read your message. Or in that case, your message should be very brief. And if you attach some pictures, some photographs, some animation, some visual effect with your messages, then your messages are more clear to the people. Now in business, in case as we are studying written communication for management, this business documents, a good business document should always answer the following question. What is this document about? Why has it come to be? Who wrote it? How is it organized? What is it trying to accomplish? What supports the conclusion? What problem or opportunity does it address? Like in business documents, we'll learn it in the later half that why a business document is required. Like who wrote it? Business document has more sanctity of written communication. There you have to be very careful. I'll discuss this in the later half. Let's go ahead. Now, first of all, we have to understand what is the importance of words, phrases and sentences in the written communication. Writing is a skill that can be learned and it will improve as you practice it. Choose right words and right phrases. Don't use unnecessary words, unnecessary phrases where it is not required. A sentence is a group of words that expresses a single complete thought. Construct grammatical and logical sentences. Use acronyms, but carefully. Like sometimes we use ampersand. In spite of writing and, A-N-D, and, we use the symbol of and. But in informal communication, you can write. If you're writing a letter to your friend like that, you can write. But if you are using it in a formal level, you are writing to your senior or you are writing to someone, government authority, then you have to spell it A-N-D. Similar things. We'll learn it in the later half. Now, whenever you are writing something, first of all, make a draft. The first rule of writing is the first draft is only the first draft, and that is the most important most experienced and effusive of writers cannot tell their story right the first time. They first make that the books that get publishers, it takes years to together to publish a book for a writer, for a competent writer, and they first of all prepare a draft. So even if you're writing a letter also, don't directly write it and make it final. You have a scratch outline, like there in your paragraph, like this, then you prepare a skeleton of your writing and then communication. What are the advantages of learn earlier? No effect of accent or colloquial pronunciation, like whenever, I don't know whether my language is clear to you, I'm simple or not, but we experience that. Like when we watch Hollywood movies, they also speak in English, but the communication is not clear because they use lingophonic English or their accent is very different that we are not able to understand, because our Indian accent and their foreign accent, there is a huge difference in that. Similarly, if a person, even interstate accent is also different. So in written communication, there is no such problem. Wherever you receive the message across the world, you won't face any problem in understanding that communication. It can be reviewed and revised. If someone finds the, no, whatever it is you have written, it is wrong, please correct it. So we may write it, yes, it is wrong, and we are really sorry for that. I'm correcting the message and I'll send it to you again. So you have a scope there to revise it or to review it, or you can correct it before sending it, even after sending it. But in case of oral communication, it's not possible. Written communication, you can maintain records of it. It can be reproduced exactly like whatever it has been written. Like verbal communication, we sometimes we say like ame kuhe sabu hale sage insada ki nahi mu sage inso kahi thili, like I spoke like that in that point of time. But in written communication, you have a proof. Yes, see, I have written this thing. So you have a proof of that. Now you have supporting or additional data. You can use, of course, whenever, like for mentioning some statistics, some graphs, some pictures, you can always add it to your written communication, which is not possible in a verbal communication. Now, there are some disadvantages of written communication also. It is impersonal in nature. Like in verbal, you got to know the other people's view also immediately. But in written communication, it's your thought and you that who is writing. Like you cannot involve people when you are writing something. May or may not read. I have sent mail regarding my message to thousands of people. Out of that, only 100 people read my message and 900 people simply ignored it. So it may happen that some people may not read your message. Slower than oral communication. Of course, oral communication, we don't have to write. We don't have to take a paper, a pen, email. We don't have to type nothing. Just whatever it's there in our heart or in our mind, we just speak that. But in case of written communication, we have to write everything, so it's a slow process. Requires storage time, it's time consuming and it's expensive. Like as people are saying that it requires store, you have to store your information, you have to make files of it, you have to store whatever you are writing, and it's time consuming. It takes a lot of time. You have to draft a letter, you have to get it typed, you have to send it to sometimes. It's expensive also, because sometimes it's consuming paper, pen and everything. So it's expensive as compared to oral communication. It requires reading and writing abilities. A person should know to read and write to communicate via written communication. Oral communication, anyone can communicate. Even a person who does not know how to read and write, they can also communicate. Like a person who is illiterate, if he wants to express something in his or own language, then they can communicate. But in case of written communication, you should have the ability to read and write. Can become public. It's sometimes it happens that you shared a message with someone and it become public. It happens like we tweet something in Twitter, and like recently we can see over the news, we tweet something in the Twitter and it becomes public because you don't have the control over it. In case of oral communication, you have your control, but in case of written communication, you don't have the control over it. It can become, anyone can forward your email to anyone. Anyone can forward your text messages to anyone. So it can become a public and not environment friendly. Why we are not saying it environment friendly? Because we are using pen and paper. So according to Go Green initiative of Government of India, we should at max use very less paper. So if you are using pen and paper for written communication, it is not environment friendly. Now, do's and don'ts while writing like your the written communication. Mind the tone, like the language you are using, it should be formal, it should be polite. Even in informal communication also, it should be polite. You should always use active voice, not passive voice. It should be always old to new, like you should start from the older things and then you should arrive to the new things. It should be from familiar to unfamiliar. Writing in an affirmative. Affirmative means in a positive sense. You should not use any negative things when you are writing. Avoid fillers, like using some jargons in between, some sayings in between. In case of business communication, you have to avoid fillers. Omit empty words like dash, 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 star, star, star. These things should be avoided in written communication. Avoid awkward phrasing, like some awkward phrases are also there. We should avoid it. There are 10 rules that we should follow while using the written communication. That is, use one syllable word in place of two syllable words, two syllable word in place of three syllable word, and so it means that don't get confused in this. It should be precise. Whatever you are writing, it should be precise. Don't stretch it. Don't use unnecessary words just to lengthen or like to make your writing large or huge. Use concrete words in place of abstract words. Use active voice in place of passive voice. Use more of verbs and nouns and less of adjectives and adverbs like the, in, he was, doing, dancing, singing, these things. No, you have to be exactly precise and to the point whatever you want to speak or what you want to communicate. Make each word count. You have to limit yourself to the words that you are using in the written communication. Keep it short and simple. It has to be very short and simple. Concentrate on paragraph development and develop only one idea in one paragraph. Like for example, in a letter, you are using three paragraphs. The three paragraphs should not be in this of same idea. It should be of three different ideas. One idea should be there in one paragraph. Relate the experience to the reader. Like your experience should reflect in your writing. Write to express, not to impress. You are writing to communicate with the front person. You are not writing that, yes, see, my English is very good. I'm writing so well. See what vocabulary I'm using, what jargons I'm using. See my expertise. You are not doing this to impress someone. You are just doing this to express your feeling to someone. Maintain the feel and rhythm in language so that the people who is reading your communication should develop an interest to read it. Now, what is the process of writing? First of all, we prepare a draft, like pre-writing phase. Then pre-writing phase means ideation. Ideation, yes, I have to write. I will write a letter. I will write a report. I'll write a memo. I'll write a concept note. Then you have to plan for it, what all things will be there. Then whatever you have planned, you have to draft it. You have to note it down. Then after you have drafted, you have prepared your entire writing. Then you have to edit it for any grammatical errors. You have used any unnecessary jargons. You have used more of passive voice. Then after editing it, you can show it to one or two persons that whatever I have written, if it is not confidential, whatever it is written, do you think that any changes are required? You can take feedback. Based on feedback, you may revise it. Then again, you shall proofread it for any grammatical errors. Then your written communication is ready to be published or to be sent. Similarly, whatever I have said, the writing process, it involves like planning. Planning, keep objects in mind and research the topic. Think about the audience to whom you want to communicate. Outlining helps to organize your thoughts. Follow your outline. Then while writing, follow your outline. Use your handbook. Jot down the points. Inspiration is acceptable but must be carefully reviewed. Use the interview approach, like who am I writing, what am I writing, where it will go, when it will reach, and how the communication is going to be interpreted. And of course, you should maintain quality. Any language you are using, whether it is Hindi, English, Hindi, Odia, or any other regional language, you should maintain the quality in it. It should be free from grammatical errors. It should be understandable. It should be free from jargon. So you have to take care of that. Now, what are the various types of written communication? The various types of written communication are email, letters, reports, cover letter, resume, curriculum vitae, manuals or procedures, memos, and minutes of the meeting. Now, first of all, let's know about email. Email is a method, you know, everyone knows what is email. Email is a method of exchanging digital messages between computer users. When we want to exchange some digital messages, then that is known as email. It is most commonly used in offices. Basically, offices only, because email communication is basically done for offices. Because nowadays, for personal messaging, we use WhatsApp, we use Facebook, we use other chats also. But email is basically done for official communication, to share ideas and documents. You can attach there. Now, around 40% of world's population has an internet connection. I think more than this. This is a backdate figure. In 1995, it was less than 1%. See, what is the revolution? 95 is almost, we can say here, within a time of 15 years, 10 years, we have reached around 40%. Only 1% people were using mail, and now 40% of world population is using email. Now, why people use email rather than writing letters? Email is fast and convenient and easy. It reaches the person within no time. Email is now the dominant method of communicating in business. It is convenient for communicating with people in different places and different time zones. Like at a time, you can send email to any person in any part of the world, not even in India. Even if a person is sitting somewhere in Europe or in America or in France or Japan, you can send the email within no time. It is easier to people with easier to communicate with people who understand written English, but don't speak it well. Even if the person, not necessarily the person, speaks a very fluent English, but written communication is a thing. When you send an email, the person will read that thing, even if it's in an English language, will try to understand, and he will try to make it personalized according to himself. He will abstract the meaning or extract the meaning from that communication, that email. Excellent mechanism for follow-up or action items after a meeting. For example, a meeting has been conducted in your office, or meeting happened in your college, or you prepared a minutes of it. Minutes means jotted points, whatever you have discussed in the minutes, colleagues or all the participants or follow.
ये देख
Sorry, sorry everyone. I don't know. I was disconnected. May I know how from how long I was disconnected?
Yes, yes.
Anyone from the student community?
Yes, you are audible. Please continue.
No, from how long I was disconnected?
May I think
know, like till what?
There is some internet issue. That's why you disconnected.
No, no, but from how long I was disconnected?
It's
I want to know.
Around 2-3 minutes, ma'am.
So what was my last topic? Can anyone remind me till where I was there? Chirasmita, are you hearing me? Chirasmita? I'm not audible clearly. Hello, Nishant. Okay, thank you. So my voice is clear or not? Please text me my voice is clear or not. Or you are having any problem? Okay, thank you so much. So we were discussing about email, right? Okay, okay, fine, fine. All right. So we were discussing about email. So till what was my last topic? Can anyone tell me email till what extent? Whether process of writing email. Did I discuss this thing? Email is fast, convenient and easy. Anyone inform the student? Okay. Then this one, effective email writing. Effective email writing, did I cover that? Okay, did you understood about mail? Should I, all right, then effective email writing, it should be in proper subject line. You have to doubly ensure your attachment. It should have a proper page layout. And you also have to keep it short and simple. You have to use the appropriate language, and you have to proofread it. And you should be careful whenever you are marking a to or a copy for the emails. Now, emails have three components. One is to, one is CC, one is BCC. When you are writing it to and CC, the persons who have marked, like for whose mail address are attached to to and CC, they can be viewed. But if you want to send it to someone else, whom you want that others should not know that that person, I'm sending that mail to that person also, then you can write, copy that mail ID in the BCC thing. Okay. Now, the challenges that we face in email is that email is not always confidential. Emails can sometimes be obtained from central network. even if it is deleted from personal computers. Even if your mails are deleted from your personal computers, they have Google have their central network from where the email can be retrieved. The challenges that we face in email is even email is often sent out without rereading, proofreading, and other standards applied to written communication. We press the send button too soon and we don't get an opportunity to retrieve the email. Google has this facility. There's a time frame of 30 seconds. Like we can indirectly undo it. So we press the send button and we can undo it for 30 seconds or 1 minute. But after that, we cannot retrieve that mail. Now, emails can be forwarded and sent to others without your approval or knowledge. Yes, anyone can forward or send your mail to others even without your approval or knowledge. Next is, what are the don'ts we should remember while writing an email? We should not use all capital words. We should not use any blank or wrong subject line in the mail. Your subject line should refer whatever there is in the contents. We should not use abbreviations like and, etc. like that. We should not use this. We should not use unnecessary words. We should give reply to an email within 24 hours. And we should also know what is the potential outcome. Your business email should be concise and to the point, and it should be in the formal language, not informal language. Now, next is letter writing. A letter writing is a written message from one party to another containing information. You have to remember three things, that there are three basic formats for a letter writing. One is full block, one is modified block, and one is simplified block. There are two extensions of this block. One is semi-block and one is modified semi-block. Now, let me explain you that. I think we're in the meeting because... full block is that when you are writing the entire thing without any paragraph, a written message from one containing information. Let me explain you it further. Now, whenever we are writing a formal letter, what things we have? We have a letterhead over the top. Then we have a sender's address. Then we have a date mentioned. Sometimes date is mentioned here also. And then sometimes the receiver's address is here or sometimes in the right hand side of the A4 size letter. Then you have a salutation like dear sir, madam, yeah, greetings like that. Then the subject and the body. And then you have valediction like regards, with warm regards like that. Then you have signature at the block. Then if you have any enclosures. So these are the things that a letter has. Now, what does a business letter should have? Now, let me show you an example of a business letter. I think I have. This is name on the letter number, reference number or your office number, your date, to whom you are sending the letter. You should have a subject. Then you have a salutation like dear or sir, dear madam, your respected sir, respected madam, esteemed. Then you have a subject. Then you have a body of the letter. Then you have to write regards like that. Then your sincerely, your signature. And this is how a formal letter should look like. Heading, letterhead, date, inside address, salutation, subject line, body, closing and signature, and then you are having the enclosures. Reference number, date, sender's address, inside address, salutation like dear sir, body text, you start, we are pleased to inform you that in reference to the above letter, we would like to inform that. Then closing, yours sincerely, then your signature. And if you have any enclosures, you can write in the end of that letter. Now, what are the complimentary closures? Yeah, starts. We started as dear sir, dear madam, dear sir, madam. If you're, it's your colleague or peer group, you can write dear Miss Kranti, dear Miss Kiran, dear Miss Kalyan. You have a dear customer, dear reader, dear subscriber, dear shareholder, dear member. And if it's your senior, then you can write respected, esteemed, honorable. You can use these words. At the end, it should be yours faithfully, yours truly. If it's a senior, and if it's your peer group, you can write yours sincerely. If it's a customer, reader, subscriber, shareholder, or a member, you can there also you can use the word yours sincerely. Now, what are the various types of letters? We have compliant letters, request letter, sales and marketing letters, get well soon letters, recommendation letters, selection or acceptance letters, rejection or reject letters. Similarly, we have letters of request, sales letter, response letters, cover letters, recommendation letters, letters of collection, letters to vendors and suppliers. Then we have these letters also continue with memos, like memos that deal with employee issues, memos that make announcements, memos for policies and procedures. Memos will deal in the later half. Now, why letters are used? Letters are used for professional, official and business communication. Again, we can have a record of it. We don't require any additional devices. Suppose you are living in a very remote area where you don't have any internet connection, or you don't have the any computer or mobile like that. Initially, it used to happen, but these days we are digital enough. So in that case, we used to write letter, then we have to post it. Then it has to be one sender and one address. And we can also send some photographs, some pictures like this. Now, why the usage of letters is diminishing? Because it's not completely secure. It takes time to reach to another place. It's time consuming. Once it is lost, it cannot be retrieved again. And it's not environment friendly because we are using paper, and paper is made of wood, and wood comes from plant, and we are not allowed to come plant because it's causing global warming. Now, 10 rules we should follow while writing a letter, because this is there in your syllabus, so you have to know about letter writing. Write original letters, reduce use of form letters. Like, you have to write the address letter. Sometimes you have templates for that, but you should always make a habit of writing it in your own word. Address the letter to a specific person. Spell the recipient's name right and every single time. This is very important. You know, people find it very annoying, and when you spell their name incorrectly or your designation incorrectly, this is the first impression you are creating in front of the reader's mind, and he is totally annoyed. He may not have very interest after reading his name incorrect or his designation incorrect. Use appropriate titles, and if possible, if you are writing a formal letter, limit the letter to a single page. Don't make it very long. Use appropriate language that the receiver should understand. If you are using too many jargons and it making it difficult for the front person to understand that letter, then your communication will not be effective. Proofread the letter. After you have finished the letter writing, you have to proofread the letter. Send neatly typed written letters. It should not be a lot of strikes in between. Cuts and then paste and then you have rubbed it. It should not be like that. It should be neatly typed, well-spaced words. In between the words, the spacing should be perfect. In between the lines, the spacing should be perfect. Use positive and courteous language. It's always good to use a positive approach to anyone, whether it's a verbal communication or a written communication. Try to avoid negativity in your letter. Never send poison pen letters to poor, unsuspecting recipients, because poison pen is like nothing like that. If you are writing letters, the pen which spreads, in that case, your entire letter will be spoiled. So you should write it in a dot pen. So next, we will learn about the report writing. Report is any informational work made with the specific intention of relaying information in a widely presentable form. Now, why do we write report? We have to write report. If we are in an office, we have to prepare a report for a particular project. We have to prepare a report if it has to be sent to government or to bank or anywhere. If we are a student, then we have to write report for our dissertation, for our thesis, or for our projects. Now, what is the purpose of writing a report? To inform. We have to inform that, yes, we have done this. To analyze a particular thing. To compare whatever we have done. Is it good or bad, or is it reached to whatever our target was? To request. If we want to report something, this is our report, please grant us some money in the basis of the report, or please grant us the, it's a request. It's an impress. If you really make a very good report, you will be impressed. Your students can impress their guides, their teachers, and the person who is going to take your viva. You will really make impress by your report. Similarly, in offices, you can impress your seniors with a very good report. Now, what are the various types of report? We have technical reports, annual reports, recommendation reports, progress reports, budget reports, credit reports, and appraisal reports. Now, what are the stages of report writing? First of all, we have to define the objective and the audience. We should know why are we making this report and who are the audience, like whether they are our seniors or we are preparing this report just for a community, like that. We have to gather then the necessary information based on our objective. Then we have to analyze the information using various tools. We can use we have various statistical techniques can be used to analyze the information. Then we have to organize the information. We will be organizing our information. We'll write a conclusion. And after that, we will write the complete report. Now, what are the titles? When you write a report, what are the titles present there? First of all, title of your report. So you write employee satisfaction summary. Survey. Suppose it's a report on employee satisfaction survey. Next is executive summary. Your entire summary of the report. Your abstract, we call it as, or executive summary, whatever you have written, concise, the summary of your report will be there in the executive summary or the abstract. Then introduction. You have to write what is this for? Why have I done the employee satisfaction survey like that? What are the materials and methods used? Like what all statistical tools you have used for collection of the data, then analysis of the data, whether it's a chi-square technique or a t-test or whatever you have used for analyzing the entire report. Then what are the results you found out and what are the discussions? Then what are the conclusions after writing your report and what are the recommendations? And one more thing you should include here that I forgot it to mention, that is the references on bibliography. So this is the entire thing that should be there in your report writing. Now, in a report layout, we have a cover page, we have a title page, we have a preface. If it's a report for a thesis or for a dissertation submission, then we have a cover page for it, we have a title page for it, we have a preface, we have to acknowledge the people who have given you help for completing this report. Then we have a table of content, of course, executive summary, the entire summary of that report in one page. In the body of the report, and then in the body it comprises of everything. That's what are the methods adopted, then analysis, your conclusion, your recommendation, and the end, references and bibliography. Now, do's and don'ts of report writing. Keep your heading simple and short. You should always use good quality paper. Because if you are using a paper of poor quality, then your report will not be very much attractive. Use adequate white space. Yes, you should not jumble the paragraphs together. You should have, basically it's 1.5 space should be there between two paragraphs whenever you are typing, and one line should be at least there between the two lines in a paragraph. Use template to save time. Nowadays we have lot many templates in Google for report writing. You can download one free template available so that you can save your time while writing a report. No more than 5 fonts. If you are using a report, if you are using different fonts for heading, different font, then for body, different font, try to use only one font if possible. But if you really want to show some creativity in the report, not more than 5 fonts. And if you are making a colorful report, basically in official documentation, it should be in one color, probably in black color. But if you want to make it more attractive and you have to use colors in that report, not more than 5 colors. No double emphasis. You should not do repetitions in your report. Once you have mentioned it earlier and again, you're repeating it again and again. No double emphasis. No weird fonts. Like sometimes we use a lot of italics or calligraphy. Those things are not understandable. People cannot read that. So don't use weird fonts. Not too much of clip art. Clip arts are sometimes very difficult to understand. If you're using images in your report, don't use too much. For example, I can show you some clip art. It's very difficult to understand. So don't use clip arts which are difficult to understand while writing your report. Now, some common errors and tips that we commit while writing a report is that we use the name of the company. It should be whatever it is mentioned in their website. Don't make a name of, we cannot make a name of our own. It has to be there. What is the name mentioned in their website? We cannot use shorthand typing while writing in our report, like through, through cannot be THRU. It has to be THROUGH. Condition. It should not be. It has to be full form. Management. We cannot write MGMT. Reference. We cannot write ref. Nib. Library. LIB. It has to be full word with proper spelling. We should avoid repetition of words in a sentence. You should not use two words together. Apart from the adverb you are using, but you should not use two words together in one sentence. So use repetition of words. Like here it is written, the file in the file folder. So this is a repetition. Three times the word file has been used. And use of ampersand. Ampersand with this and symbol. Use it AND. Use of bold. Bold only wherever necessary. Don't bold the entire report so that it will be black in color. It won't look good. Bold is very essential. Then you mark it as bold. Your headings, your subheadings, sometimes we have to mark it as bold just to make it look different. Uppercase. Use commas to separate elements. Your entire report should not be in uppercase. Only the main heading can be in uppercase. Apart from that, you should not use uppercase throughout, like the total thing in uppercase throughout your report. Use comma to separate elements in a series and to separate ideas on clauses. Use correct punctuation and abbreviation. Example, for example, that is, etc. These are the correct abbreviations you should not use. Do not use multiple punctuation marks for formal. For example, we use a lot of exclamation signs together. You should not use that. Only one exclamation sign. A lot of question marks together as we write in WhatsApp or we chat with someone. We do it too many times. We should not use it. Only one exclamation mark at a time or only one question mark at a time. Then hyphen and dash usage, it should be minimal. It's and then other one is it is. Both have different meanings. So you have to know where to use it is and where to use its. Use of apostrophe. Apostrophe is also not required anywhere. You have to be very particular whenever you are using the apostrophe. Use active voice and proofread for your accuracy. Next is the goal of, now what are the instruction manuals and process description? The goal of written communication, written instruction is to completely simplify a procedure with no room of doubt. Because if you are writing something, it is a proof, it is a record. So it has to be very much clear, very much brief, very much precise. You cannot write unnecessary things in your written communication because it will be a proof for you. You have to follow procedural guides whenever you're writing a, you have to follow due protocol. If you're writing a formal letter, a formal written report or a formal memo, it varies in length depending on the complexity. Then if you are having any trouble or something like that, then you have to repair it in its proper time. Next, one more thing that comes under writing is CV. CV is also a written thing, that is curriculum vitae. A written overview of a person's experience and other qualification for a job opportunities. CVs may be requested for applicants to post-secondary programs, scholarships, grants, and bursaries. CV, curriculum vitae, is a Latin expression which can be loosely translated as the course of your life. Means it's your biography that you are presenting while doing some job, or you want to write a paper or write a book. Then people now and then ask for your CV, that we want to know your background information, your subject expertise, your domain knowledge, your field work. So CV is also a part of writing, and your CV should be impressive, attractive, and well drafted. Now, similarly, CV, resume is another form of CV. More or less, they are sister concerns only. It's also a written document used to present backgrounds and skills. Mostly, it is used for new employment. A summary or relevant job experience and education, as its French origin applies, it has arrived from a French word, resume. Then it is used to screen applications followed by interviews. So what are the do's and don'ts that we should keep in mind while preparing our resume? We have to be honest. We should not produce any fake information in our resume or in our curriculum vitae. List only significant or relevant details. Back your claim with evidence. If you are showing, yes, I was the best student, or I have won a gold medal or like that, then you have to produce evidence for it also. Use good quality paper whenever you are submitting your resume. Proofread your resume. Do not exaggerate or brag. do not begin sentences with I. You should not begin sentences with I. Do not use technical jargons and do not overdo. Overdo the use of capitals and boldface. Like doing bold it again and again, using capital words again and again. You should limit it as far as possible. Because you know what happens, why it is telling again and again you should not use capital words again? Because sometimes you are reading a sentence in a flow and suddenly capital word come in between. Then it attracts the attention of the reader that what is this? Then he will stop reading in between. The flow will be disturbed. So it is always advisable until and unless it is required and as per protocol, like for the nouns, we have to use capital words, or else don't use capital words now and then. And don't boldicize the thing. No, don't make it bold on and often. Resume format should be always chronological, like from your recent then to your past experiences. Reverse chronological order, basically your first job first, then after that it will follow like that. And because reverse chronological order is formed by, is basically preferred by the conservative and traditional companies, they focus on your work experience and applicable, and your skill set should be mentioned clearly. Now, resume format, there are basically three, if it's a functional resume, like you have to highlight your skills only, achievements and responsibilities. You don't have to share, you don't have any, this is basically the functional resume is for the freshers, those who don't have any experience or any job experience. In that case, they can highlight their skills, their responsibilities, their abilities, their strengths, that how can the person can do the job history. The functional resume do not have a work history. Basically, the functional resume is used for the persons who are freshers. Second is the achievement. Achievement means who are working. In that case, this is the very powerful format of resume writing. They have no heading. 4 to 5 achievement statement you will write in the first after writing your name and mail address. This is I am achieved. And these 2 achievements, you have to provide proof for that. And this will allow you to showcase your strengths to the recruiter or to the wherever you want to project your resume. And again, there is another format of resume that is hybrid, that is both functional as well as this achievement is there. Here you have also demonstrating your skill set and also about your job experience. So it is basically this hybrid form of resume is used widely among people. You have varied and unrelated work experience. You have short work history. You want to highlight relevant internships and other assignments. Basically for them, this hybrid format is used. Now, resumes that rock means what kind of resumes are very impressive and very attractive. Resumes which are simple, concise and short. Attention, interest, desire and action are the AIDA principle of resume. You have to be concise, say less, but one page profile is preferred by the recruiters these days. Professionals are, like for example, the resume you must have come across nowadays, digital resume, where you at a time, you just highlight your achievements, your strengths, that's it. You don't have to write paragraph after paragraph, I did this, in matriculation, I got this. No one is interested. They will be interested more in what job profile you are applying for and what is the skill set they demand in that job profile. So accordingly, you have to modify your resume whenever you are applying for different jobs. So that writing habit also you have to be expert in and you have to practice. Now, what is a cover letter? Now, you cannot just post a resume directly. You have to attach a cover letter or just an application that, yes, I'm this and this and I'm applying for this and this job. Please find my resume enclosed here. But it's a product manual or a cover letter or a sales pitch. It introduces you to the prospective employer. It's an elevator pitch in a written form. You should always use paragraph format whenever you are using a cover letter. But why do we need a cover letter? But these days, cover letters are in email. You don't have to attach any cover letter because in the body of the email only you are going to introduce yourself. But if you are sending your resume by post, then it's better you should attach a cover letter along with it. When your cover letter attracts interest, employers read your resume. When you write a cover letter, be respected sir, esteemed sir, dear sir, and this and this that, with your language, he will be impressed, and so that he will develop interest to look at your resume. It will help to personalize yourself with the reader. Cover letter gives energy to your resume. It provides relevant information. It may be moderately informal, and it should be interesting to read. Then three paragraphs. First of all, talk about yourself. Introduce yourself in the cover letter. In the second paragraph, talk about the company, that why you want to join that organization. In the third paragraph, you write that why you are fit for that organization. In these three paragraphs, you have to write your you have to express to the recruiter about yourself in the cover letter. Then this is one style. Then the second style is about highlighting your I'm fit for that. In one paragraph, you can finish everything. But better to use the first. Talk about yourself, highlight your then talk about the company, and then highlight your skills. Now, what are the rules that we should follow? You should always send a cover letter with the resume, and you should always customize cover letter. Restrict cover letter to one page. Don't make it too lengthy, that the reader will feel bored while reading your cover letter. Do not make spelling or grammatical mistakes. Include appropriate keywords wherever required. Do not use the cover letter as an excuse to brag. Like, just do not plead in front of everyone that, please sir, I need this job, I'm so I'm unemployed, I don't have money, my financial condition is very low. Don't write all those things. You are not begging anyone. Just show your potentials and you are fit for this and you deserve this job. Use concrete language and provide evidence. Whatever you are writing, provide evidence to it. Provide your experience certificate if possible, your mark sheets if possible, your certificates that you have earned if possible. Do not use unnecessary humor. Don't use any humor in the cover letter. Use a suitable format and structure, like it should be 12 size font, a Times New Roman. Don't italicize everything. Don't use calligraphies at all. And it has to be in a structured way. Then don't send same cover letter to two recruiters. Never do that. You have to type different cover letters to different persons. So this we learned about cover letter. The next very important thing is memo. Memos or memorandum. Memos are very important thing, like we send memos basically in official or in business communication. Memos are note regarding something for future, to mention, call to mount, recount or relate. It must be remembered. Its plural form is memoranda or memorandum. Maybe short, half a page or long. E-memo is less formal and is shorter in length. Now, what is the purpose of memo? Why we issue memo? To record any information, to motivate for action. In memo, less you have worked very good, please continue. Your officer can write you. To issue a directive, a memo can be used. That's from this date. This information is, we are issuing this directive. It's basically an official communication. To convey an idea, to reprimand. For example, for reminding someone, as a reminder also we can send a memo. Now, memos format and tips. What should be there in a memo? Memo also there should be to, and then from, then date, and what is the subject of the memo, and then the body of the memo. Now, while writing a memo, you should remember APPLE, as acronym APPLE. A stands for audience, P for purpose, P for point, L for limit, and E for emphasize. So you should know your audience, to whom you are issuing a memo. What is the purpose? It has to do the point. You have to limit yourself. So you cannot write too many things in the memo. Unless it is a memorandum of understanding, it's a different thing. Then second is emphasize. You have to emphasize your particular information. What do you want to communicate? This is all about memo. The next thing is research paper. Research paper also we have to write sometimes. So it's also a type of written communication. Here you have to organize, analyze a subject. You have to document your work, incorporate the findings. Then you have to do the analysis, you have to access the observation, and then you have to repeat the experiment. First of all, you have to prepare a proposal. For preparing a proposal, written offer to solve a technical problem. Why do we do research? We do research for two things. Either we have to solve a problem or we have to explore something. 1 minute. Written. Next is a proposal. Proposal, what is proposal? Proposal is a written offer to solve a technical problem or to undertake a project or practical. Now, why do we do research? We do research to solve a problem, or we do research when we have to reach to a certain conclusion or we want to explore something. So we can write a proposal to request for a quotation, or and also we write a proposal for requesting for a quotation or inviting a bid, a tender. We write a proposal. Sometimes we also write a proposal for marketing brochures and all. Now, what should be the proposal stage structure? It should have a title, it should have a contract, executive summary. In the preparatory, in the first part, in the main body, we need to have an introduction, a technical and management section, and its cost estimate. If you are proposing for a project, then its cost estimate. Then in the supplementary part, we can keep the appendix and of course the references and sources. So this is about a proposal. Next is minutes of meeting. This is one of the very important thing. If you are working in an office, or if you are a student or you are holding a gathering, you should always prepare a minutes after a meeting so that it can be kept in record and you can take action for that particular minute accordingly. Now, what is a MOM? Reiterate or recapitulate the proceedings of a meeting. MOM, minutes of the meeting, is the reiterate or recapitulation of the proceedings of a meeting. It should contain the points discussed in the meeting. It should contain the argument presented. It should contain the decision. It should also contain the responsibilities assigned. Now, it should not contain descriptive adjectives. Minutes of the meeting should not contain any descriptive adjectives. Now, what are the MOM formats? There is no fixed format, but it contains, first of all, who all were there in your meeting. Now, what is the name of the document? What was the meeting for? For example, it is a meeting related to some like gender sensitization or related to some admission or examination like that. What is the type of meeting? Like whether it was the minutes of the meeting, what, who all the, it's a, which committee meeting? For example, we have different committees in different organizations. We have finance, we have purchase. What was the type of meeting? Then you have to mention the date of meeting and then time of meeting. In the body items, what you will include? Meeting announcement. When was this meeting announced? What are the old items related to the meeting and new items? In the closed meeting, then we'll be announcing that. In the body, you'll be also noting down the points that is related to your discussions or the arguments or the decisions made. And in the next, in the closing item, you will be just writing down that what will be the next meeting, how it was closed, and the initials of the members who were present in the meeting. So this is all about writing. All holy books, either Gita, Quran or Bible, they are written 1,000 years of ago, but they are still widely followed and read. And this is the power of written communication. So thank you. If you have any doubts, you can please ask to me. I hope I'm clear to you. If you have any doubt, please let me know. I think I'm clear to everyone. If you have any doubt, friends, you can ask to me. And if I'm not clear, I think I could explain you about written communication properly. If any doubts of any topic you want that you feel that is left uncovered, you please let me know. No doubts? So if Hima madam is there, if the participants don't have any doubt, I think we can close the meeting, because I have covered the topics, whatever was there in the written communication. Okay, friends. I think she must be busy somewhere. So I think I'm clear with everyone. Thank you all for joining in this meeting. And if you have any doubt, please let us know via email or our grievance redressal portal if you want to learn more about this written communication. And related to any doubt, my mail ID and my phone number is mentioned in the staff profile of our university official website. You can just call me or text me there or just mail me in my mail address. Please do submit your feedback regarding this class. And it was nice interacting with you all. Thank you for your time and attention. Thank you all. So we are formally closing the meeting. Thank you. Thank you so much.